If you're joining us live, we'll be starting here in a little while. If you're watching this on YouTube, it's not live anymore. That's a surprise. We put this up on YouTube after the fact. And if you want to watch it on when it's live, you watch us on Facebook. You join the group SV Seeker on Facebook. It's a group. And we have a page, but there's also a group that you have to gain membership to, which means you have to have, you have to look like a real person on Facebook to do that. But welcome this morning. And man, is it hot and humid. I got a bunch of great people in. They're laying out. We're getting ready to punch holes for grommets on the mizzen mast, and they're making sure everything's straight. You don't have a metric tape in your hand, so right now, no, you're not a metric boat.
Oh, the bottom's not metric?
I have a metric tape. It makes you feel better.
It's got both of them.
Yeah. Does it?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That's the tape.
Not to totally distract y'all, but this is the biggest worm I've ever seen.
Feet and inches.
Okay, we'll do feet and inches.
That's a baby worm.
Oh, you got a good one.
Is this
normal?
Yeah.
Totally normal.
Did you see a picture of the one he posted the other day?
Wait, that beetle?
Was that real?
That's real.
Wait, you talking about that weird beetle?
No, he's talking about this worm. It's like
giant earthworm.
It looks like a 2.5-inch diameter earthworm. Yeah.
You can hear him.
It's one of Andrew's things. All right. For way of an introduction, this is Craig Durkin.
Hey.
We're going to talk about what he does. He does concrete jungle. And this is Kitty and Andrew Quitmeyer. He's a professor at, what's the name of the university?
National University of Singapore.
He's got a gig working in Singapore. He does electronics and field stuff with bugs and electronics. And Jonas, what's your specialty? Hating school?
Yeah.
Hey, you and me, man. We're together on that one. And let me show you what's going on in the shop. I got several things to point out there and some thank yous to do for you. And it is Memorial Day weekend. So for all of you remembering those who have gone before us and left us a better path, I'm much obliged. I posted a thing this morning. Today's got me thinking about my dad. And I say this to a lot of people. Let me get the camera situated a little better here. I often get asked, why'd you decide to start doing this? And one of the big answers to that is I lived the first part of my life a lot like my mother, and it was being concerned about, everything, like a normal mom would be. And she's a lovely woman, but she was one of those, you don't go into the water and swim, until an hour after you've eaten, and those type of things, were out too far on the surf. And my dad was just the polar opposite of that. And I think it had a lot to do with his war experience, which he didn't fight as combat, but he saw it. He drew maps, invasion maps out in the Pacific for the next island, And he came back, I think, changed from that, like a lot of that generation did, in that an appreciation that life is short and you don't have really any control over about when your number's up. Today we train our military like nobody's going to get hurt, we're going to think about every possible scenario. We make them into paranoid, walking, pathetic people. I'm sorry if you're in, don't think that qualifies for everybody. But a lot of the guys came back from World War II is like, damn, you can do what you like, but when your number's up, your number's up. And so I think they came back with a real appreciation for life and living it to the fullest while they had it. And my dad lived his life like that. When you go out on a trip with mom and dad, it's going to be, everything's going to be fine because dad's not going to, he's controlled by mom. But when you went out with dad alone, oh my God, okay? And he could come up with this, it didn't faze him. It didn't matter what was wrong. He flips the fuel tank on the airplane and it didn't have any fuel in it, so the engine stops. I'm looking for a place to land. There's nothing but jungle beneath us. He just wasn't fazed. He'd go through all the checks, and the engine fired right back up when he figured out, and he switched fuel tanks back. And his way of testing it, was flip back to that fuel tank that had no fuel in it, just to make sure that was really the issue. So he was just a remarkable man that had a real pleasure and enjoyment for life. And I didn't understand that. When I was growing up, he just scared the shit out of me. I really appreciate what he did. And I appreciate what that whole generation did as far as, paving the road for us to take chances and learn what risk is. Anyway, enough on that. So happy Memorial Day to everybody. Let's see, is a live feed working thing?
I think so. I'm not working so well, but you're up there.
I'm up there, okay, that's all that matters. I'm going to go through a long list of stuff. This goes back into the shop. That goes back up. We got some blowers in. I'm thinking about air for the engine room. And this little puppy was put up on, what's that? I love this site. Where I get my hydraulic stuff from. It's Surplus City. And so we're going to build a duct in somewhere. And I think we're going to blow from the cargo hold into the engine room and then duct it down so it goes across the floor. That was somebody's suggestion. I like that. So it picks up the cool air and any fumes and any moisture that's gathered underneath the tiles, and it lifts that air through the tiles up through the engine room floor. And we're going to put a big Wiley port up there in the back. And we got hatches. I'll go show you the hatches that they worked on last year. But this is cool. This is like, and it's a lot of air. Maybe it doesn't say it on here. It was like, it pulls 9 amps, RPM, 12 volt. You think it would say, I think it was 640 cubic feet per minute. That seems like a lot, but that's great if it does. And we've got, you got them? Okay. Just set it down on the deal there. Bart has work for you guys to do.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm going to have you clear this table off pretty soon. Okay. You got stuff to move outside here.
Yeah.
No, not right now. We got our grommet gadget worked out, and that'll be on. I'm way behind on videos. You know, we've been doing a lot of work. So I haven't got videos out yet. This is our grommet tool, and it's got a cutting board on it so we can punch holes on that end, slide it down, and put 2 grommets on. It works great. There's our grommets, and there's our samples that we've been working on, so we can smash the poo out of them, and we use the impact wrench to do that with, so you'll be seeing that on a video. That's not my idea. I appreciate everyone who kicked that in. We're also looking at rearranging how the winches are working on the boat. We had a nice discussion, a lot of good input on Facebook about where the winches should go. And I kind of want to route the lines overhead. Sometimes they take them out, take them down to the sides, but that means stepping over a line. And I just can't see getting people to do that without falling. So I'm thinking about, well, it'd be a little easier to see, but we're going to think about redoing our winches. And so what we have is, right now we've got a winch that's based around a hydraulic hub motor and a hub with a brake system on them. And Andrew, he can't help it being a hand. If you've watched Hacking the Wild, that's the host of the show out there. Great show too if you're going to catch it. So anyway, I think we need to go with something, a smaller winch, but I like it because this is heavy. And I could, if I... Something more compact is what I'm looking at. This is on our website. If you go to our website, it's svseeker.com, of course. And then somewhere under sailboat winches. And yeah, there's a picture of a winch there. But I have the plans for this one drawn up, and I'd like to improve it. I like the idea. I want something that's hydraulic, and I want something that's manual. It could be either or, and easily to switch between one and the other. So that design we're looking to improve here shortly. And this is the bolt, the nut, rather, that holds down our tiles out there. I asked about that. And Mike, what's Mike's last name? Came by here.
Machinist. Nice guy.
Mike from Catoosa.
Yeah, he's from Catoosa.
Well, just say Mike from Catoosa.
Well, it's really close. It's only
in
my tongue.
It'll be in a video.
Yeah. He came by here, and he's working on us. He's a machinist, and he's been doing it for... eons, until 20 years, I think. And then he had a stroke, so he's recovered from his stroke now so that he can run his machines again. He's going to fashion us some prototypes for a crowned, slightly crowned nut to go on here and weld it onto a piece of all thread. A lot of you suggested plastic, and I was thinking about that too, but then Bart said, or somebody said, we're going to drop stuff on it. And it's like, yeah, that plastic's going to shatter. And see, this nut also, a lot of you gave me those plug things. This thing has to, its duty is also to spread, have a head that's big enough to spread out and hold the tiles in place. So if there was a bump or we leaned the boat a long way and something fell against the backside of the tile, it wouldn't knock it out of the floor, because then walking through the cargo hold could be, or the engine room especially, could be a real experience at night if the tile's out of place. And we bought some brand new grinders, okay? I love DeWalt. But God bless them, they really screwed the pooch on this thing. You know what they've done? I saw that button on there and I was like, oh cool, you know, I've got that trigger lock so you can pull the trigger and then push the button and lock it. That ain't what that is anymore. Now, because of all the freaking safety Nazis, you push that and then you pull the trigger. I like that. That's okay too. But you can't lock the trigger on. So you can't rest your hand and run the grinder because it's running, and if you dropped it, it would still be running. Well, if you're stupid enough to do that in a bad situation, you're stupid enough to learn the hard way, right? Fuck. So they take this shit off. Just, God damn it. Then the other thing they did here is like, what the fuck? You know, it's like you get these engineers, and it's like they get in the job, and it's like, I got to do something new, or they're gonna, you know, I'm not gonna be worth my. Well, don't fuck something up that works fine, okay? What they did, look at this. They took a perfectly good grinder. That is what you get now. And then they say this part's in the box, right? And it's not attached. You know, I'm gonna get some of those my old collets off the old one. They used to have a thing that threaded onto here, but they don't give you that. They give you this stupid thing now. I have figured out any reason for it, right? And then the old deal that held the disc on used to just be a flat one. You could take them off any of your grinders and interchange them. Not anymore. It's got a neck on it now, okay? And so the disc goes on, and then the stupid neck goes down in there, and that tightens up. So now, if you take this stuff off so you can put a cut brush on here, you better remember where you laid this crap down, because you're going to have to go find it when you take that cut brush back off and put this shit back on. So it's like,
so how do you really feel?
Fuck you, DeWalt. God damn it. You had something that worked fine. It's interchangeable with all my other grinders, and now I get this piece of shit that I can't. God damn it.
Well, right? I'd say if anybody happens to have old ones they're not using anymore and they're just sitting in the garage, we have a home. We have a home for retired DeWalt grinders.
I have a box somewhere of my old little rings, and I hope I have enough of them that I can throw this shit away and make this one work like an old one. But anyway, don't mess with stuff like that. Anyway, somebody sent me a beautiful little, this is an envelope, and they recycled paper. This person is like saving the planet, okay? And not only that, beautiful artwork on there. Who'd this come from?
It's on the check.
It's on the check. They sent me a check, and this check is for our scholarship fund. We have a scholarship fund. It's money that we won't use for building the boat. It's money we'll use for your operation when we bring a researcher, a marine biologist, or oceanographer, or something like that. So we have a check from George from
Albany, wasn't he?
Well, the check, this says Albany, but this says Saranac Lake, New York.
Whoa.
So thank you very much,
that's
George,
for
your
there.
Contribution. We appreciate it. I mean, that's really trusting in us this far out. And I love the artwork. He took it off something because it's even got our mermaid up there, but he put it on
his
envelope. I think he did. I don't think that's really
our
artwork.
I feel my job is threatened.
Good job, George. Keep her on her toes. All right. And this came in. I didn't even look who this was. Yeah. This is Michael Warlick. And this is beautiful. It's a throw line. He did a gorgeous job. He's got to have something inside. This is called a monkey's fist. And it's well done, but it's a throw line, so you can heave this line over, and then somebody else can pull a heavier line over with that, and it's even got the lanyard clip on it. So.
I think the reason for
beautiful
that
work.
Is if
beautiful.
You hook that up to that life ring, and once I'm pissed off and I get in the water to go far, far away,
that's
you say, no, don't leave.
I can throw that out to you?
Right.
Okay.
Where's sure
he from?
Oh,
he's from, is that Kathleen, Georgia?
Michael Warlick, you're welcome.
So Michael,
thank you
very much. I appreciate it. Oh, and then we're going to be laying out sailcloth on this table today. So the guys are going to be moving stuff out here shortly. Aren't they working?
Because they're on Brit. When you stop working, the world stops.
Hey!
Working.
Hey! Start moving this stuff out.
Moving things?
Yeah, you're moving things.
Woohoo! Where's the rest?
Meanwhile, while he's gone, I'm just going to show you these new coffee mugs.
No, not this. This stuff. Mark,
sir.
See the coffee mug? See? And it's got the Poseidon on the front, Explore, Dream, Discover on the back, svseeker.com, just in case you forget where to find us. The outside is a matte white porcelain finish. The inside is a glossy glaze. They're lovely. It's just right for the big giant button for coffee on my Keurig, which is great. Keeps it warm, nice big handle. The other thing is, probably in a few weeks we'll have new thermal mugs in because we've sold out totally.
Yeah.
But new design, new color.
Yeah, you're turning. I'm going to see if they break the door over there. Oh, come on. It's just a small door.
Where's, if Jack were here, he could open it really easy.
Did you guys pull the pin down?
You see
below?
This? Look at this orange one.
Yeah, this is good.
Lift it. That pin comes all
it's
way
heavy,
out.
But it won't hurt.
There, I don't think there's a pin.
Alright.
Yeah. Smack it, babe.
Well, it's, that ain't gonna do it. You're gonna have to put some oomph into it.
Well, how
about it? No,
oh, there we go.
That's going. Building gonna fall down. There it is.
Nice.
All this humidity, it swelled it up.
No, no, it goes back on the grommet.
Find the bar
that
goes in
that yet.
That hole too, and then everything on that table comes over here. Jonas, you do this. Jonas, everything here, pick it up and start as tight as you can and arrange it on that table. They gotta have all this clear. Okay. This is going to be sale layout day. I spent a lot of time. See, it's on my laptop, but I can't pull it up right now. It takes too long. So we've got all the measurements for the new panels. And,
well, I don't think I was standing right in front of it, so everybody didn't get to see the mug exactly.
They didn't get to see the mug.
So we have to do this again. See, we have the front and the back.
And we have sold a lot of these, so thank
well,
you guys.
So many, just flying off the shelf. And the other thing is,
I didn't think
we're working
buy
on
a
Grinder God shirt, so we've only got a few left of the old design. And they're, you know, we only have extra large and 2Xs in those, so snap them up now.
In case they like the old design better than the new improved design.
Yeah, because you really might. So there's some people that want one of everything, and I can't blame them. It's great stuff, isn't
it? Oh, okay,
it?
That's enough. That's enough. Yeah, that sheet of aluminum comes in here and sits on top of this. So don't take any tea.
Mm-hmm.
That's mine.
Everything
else goes. Hey, we can just put this in the floor.
Sheet over near the school bus,
okay.
Doug?
Huh?
Sheet over near the school
yeah,
bus.
Yeah, Bart knows which one.
Okay.
He'll help you with it. Oh, let's go up on the boat and take a look around up there. Any questions, Betsy? You guys can ask questions. You know, she actually reads the screen there and she'll shout it out to me. And then we're going to talk to, I introduce these folks to you. How do you like living in Singapore?
I like it, yeah, it's a nice place.
But you've lived in China too?
Yeah.
How long did you live in China?
Almost a year. So Singapore's a lot less
chaotic.
What
were you guys doing in China?
We taught English for a year.
Oh, you and Andrew did?
Yeah, yeah.
Was this like a long time ago?
It was 2008 to 2009. So, you know, getting on towards 10 years almost, yeah.
And so Singapore is very much like China?
No, well, in some ways, but they call it.
Were you in Shenzhen?
Shenzhen, yeah.
Shenzhen.
Yeah, Shenzhen.
Shenzhen, yeah. Or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the free economic zone that you're talking about.
Yeah.
That's more capitalist than communist.
Yeah, it's like hyper-capitalism. Kind of. Singapore, some people call it Asia 101, because it's like everybody speaks English.
Oh, okay.
It's really easy to get around. You know, people stand in line in a way in China. Like, people don't really like to stand in line. It's just every line becomes like a big bottleneck kind of thing. So,
oh, this is Kitty. I think I did an introduction earlier, but this is Kitty.
Giving my perceptions of what life in Singapore is like. Yeah.
Yeah.
The food is amazing. It's way too hot, but it's very nice. Yeah, it's cool.
Yeah, this isn't even hot to you here, is it?
No, this is like comfortable. Yeah,
yeah.
I'm usually just drenched in sweat. Like
I'm sweating like a baby
today, yeah.
Because this is hot to me.
Yeah,
yeah. What's the humidity there? Does it rain every day or every other day?
During the rainy season, which I think is just ending.
You got a monsoon season?
It's like, yeah, it's like every day around 3 p.m. or so. It's just like
giant
downpour. Yeah, but I think we're getting into the dry season now, which really gets even hotter apparently.
Yeah.
So. Not looking forward to that.
And your hobby is knitting brain caps right now.
Yeah, yeah. And I also knit a lot of amigurumi.
It's actually a cap that's knitted that looks like a brain, which is kind of cool.
That was for the March for Science that happened on April 22nd. I had a bunch of friends who were marching in the States while I was in Singapore, so sort of like the pussy hats that people wore for the inauguration day. But these were just brain hats. I mean, you know those, right? But
they're
just
I don't just know cat, those, but
no?
To hear you describe
it's just like
it,
cat just ears. Like, I know that sounds worse than it is. But they're just little cat ears.
Cat.
You know, they call them pussy hats because of the whole grab thing. But you know all those people marching with their pink hats on? Yeah.
Yeah.
They're cat
no,
ears,
I didn't
yeah.
watch any of that stuff.
Well,
I'm sorry.
That's fine.
I find it less painful in life to be disconnected from politics
I know
for this period of my life.
And my way to contribute to it, and like I can't protest and I don't really want to particularly, but I can knit the hats for my friends.
Right.
So for the March for Science, people were wearing brain hats instead. So
oh, okay.
I made all these 12 brain hats for my friends who were
marching. In
in from a 3,000-foot altitude, what's March for Science?
What's March? Oh,
explain it.
Oh, yeah, sure. So it was on Earth Day, and yeah. It was sort of like the women's protest. This was like a scientist protest against the idea of fake news and alternative facts and all that.
So on all that topic, where do you go for your news on science?
On science? I mean, I don't read a ton of science news, but yeah. I read the New York Times sometimes, you know.
That's your best outlet right now, you think?
I mean, that's a tough question.
I know it's a tough question, because I haven't found a decent... Everything's got to have an opinion on it now.
Yeah.
I don't want your opinion. I want information.
There's no such thing as
like there'll be something above Bill Nye that's not, you know.
Yeah. Well, I don't have the definitive answer, but I do think it's important to listen to scientists in a way that, you know, a lot of...
That's what the march is about, is focusing attention on what scientists are saying.
And I think it was specifically climate change. Like, climate change is really happening. Let's stop listening to what politicians say about it, as much as, like, could we talk to the 98% of scientists who agree that climate change exists and that we should do something about it? But also, just in general, you know, it was pro-science funding and that they're trying to cut all this national science funding and everything. And, you know, also all kinds of things.
It sounds like we give a lot to the sciences.
Yeah. No, and it seems like, you know, we're cutting it down. And so, yeah, just sort of let's listen to experts in some fields, you know. There's like this whole anti-expert thing, which I think I understand. Experts aren't always
right. You think there
are some
scientists that have sold out to political interests?
There are the 2% of scientists who say that, like, climate change isn't happening. And I don't know what is going on with them, but I wouldn't be surprised
Like the environment we've created is going to draw some people to be politicized. Because they're scientists, but they're also politically minded. And so they're... it's going to warp
is.
Their science. You know?
Yeah.
I think that's probably one of the things that I see that... Don't mar up the edges too badly. Like, put a piece of wood underneath that.
Yeah, we should put some underneath.
Get a block.
I think it's sort of like how they used to have, you know, studies that said that smoking was good for you or whatever. You can
bend
things however
that's
you
true.
Want them
that's
to.
True. So it's not a new thing, is it?
No, I don't think so, but I do think it's like very politicized right now. And
it seems so incredible. I don't know, maybe it's always been that way, but I just can't stand it.
Yeah.
It's like those two... You know, science and politics and religion, the three just don't mix.
Yeah. And it's a funny thing about living in Singapore is that people talk about climate change all the time. It's like an accepted fact.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. And, like, there's not a governmental thing being like, we don't use those words. You know, those are, like, bad words and we don't believe in that.
You don't have a petroleum industry there. Yeah, you do.
I mean, we must, yeah. But it is a pretty... the energy of the city is pretty clean. I've seen things about how much of it is based on, like, solar power, renewable energy stuff. It's, like, a lot. I don't remember how it all works, but it's pretty good, yeah. Let's see, Singapore's not perfect.
Let me move the camera so we can see what they're doing out there, too. They're moving a table. It's actually just a big piece of aluminum.
Yeah.
You think they need help?
Yeah, it kind of looks like it, yeah.
You want to grab this pair of gloves right there.
Are there?
Yep.
You know, it's been funny. I feel like I've ever not moved one of these pieces of sheet. I think I'll just stand back and watch today. This is not a small piece of aluminum. It's I think this one is 3/16 inch thick. And it's about 24 feet long. And it's 6 feet across. Now you're doing it.
Yeah.
Look
at that kit
power. There you go.
Got a good bend to it.
You guys might just lay it over and me get in there. And...
Is that a good angle? This is a good angle, yeah.
Do we care about top or bottom here?
We do.
It'll fit in the door.
Which side do we want up, Betsy?
I think we want the other side.
You guys want to straighten out this way?
Okay.
So you guys, go that way. And then we're going to lean it over. I'm going to get on the other side, and we'll lift it up and just walk it in.
We want shiny side up.
We want shiny side up.
Is my side the shiny side?
No.
Okay. Your side, Kitty.
Low, but not yet.
All right, guys, lean as far as you can so you're uncomfortable.
Like towards me?
Towards you, just the way you're going. You're
going
fine.
Okay.
We're going to lift it.
Jesus Christ! Oh, is that what we're supposed to be like?
Yes, aluminum is very lightweight.
Okay.
Keep going.
Good work.
I want about a foot off the end of the table there.
Put it on the end.
Put it over so it's not on my hand. Right there.
Somewhere.
Now down.
Yep.
Beautiful.
Woo!
We
got enough there to clamp it on the edge?
Yeah, so move all that crap.
Holy shit.
So it can go underneath, like that.
Underneath.
And look, bring the
salt
back in here.
Like
can you guys walk past that
on right
now?
Yeah.
Make a nice hallway.
Okay, just go up on the boat. All right, that was my work for the day. I'm done. Thank you, guys. Did a wonderful job. Hey, you need to help with Bart, too, and stand these others back up, lock them down. Okay. Someday we're going to build a tender, and we won't have that to do. Look at these beautiful hatches. Norman was here. He's gone. Norman's a cool dude. Norman is working with, he's gone up to a place to work with, I think it was mentally disabled adults. They have a farm where you can volunteer and go to it. And stay there. So he's going to be up there for the next two months, I think. So and hopefully we'll see him back here because he did a fantastic job. These are our hatches, and I'm still out of breath. And we got a lot of suggestions on designs for them. So we're going to start with this, but I've got good ideas, and I appreciate, you know, just because we don't use your idea for something doesn't mean we don't appreciate it, because there's always changes on it. A lot of people watch our channel. They'll get the ideas. Those ideas will stay on Facebook there. I sometimes take collections of those ideas and put them onto our website. So, you know, it's nice to be able to share that information. So just because we don't use it doesn't mean your idea is not going to get used. Because I like the ones that had. I don't like the ones where the hinges. It's kind of the only way, but it seemed kind of floppy. But if the bars were big enough and built in well enough. You know, we can make the hatch do this. These hatches just flop over, so they're not nice to sit on. I'm not sure if that's a necessary thing or not. And they'll catch water, so when you close them back, all that water gets dumped inside, or at least off the edge. If you do it slow, it would probably be all right. But anyway, there's some downsides I can see to doing that. So I like the hatches that do, you know, this thing. But right now, what we get is we just did same type hinges on both sides. You pull two pins, you open it this way. You pull these two pins, you open it this way. That's the way it works. Let me get a little better shot of it here if I can show you. And so I'm going to get some of those tractor pins that, you know, they got a, I'm not sure what they're called, clip rings is what I used to call them for the three-point hitch. And you put the pin through and it's got a wire that comes around and snaps on this end. Then we need some kind of a tether for it. So right now it's pinned on the other side, so it opens up like that. And this one's tethered out there. But the idea of pitching them, so you can pitch them into the wind and you catch, if you're on an anchor and the wind's blowing, you can lift these up and force air in through here. Or lift them up like this and let it be a good ventilation out if you're forcing air in up front. So beautiful job on that. There's our octopus tentacle that you saw us cast at some point. And they're done. And see this, and this forward hatch is done too. I got one more that we got to get done. And that's the very forward one. But this is the bigger one up here. And I've decided this is going to be our bathtub. Yeah, everybody needs a bathtub, right? You know, when we get... He custom did where the hinges locate so that they can open back without hitting anything. And so if you wanted to switch this around, you would just... Yeah, that's bolts up right there. So you pin this side, and then you pull those bolts and see how it works. So it's easy to do. Really like that. Nice to get a little more ventilation down in there, too. Okay. What else did we do? Well, can't think of anything else that we did up here this week. Norman mainly worked his last part of that week on all those hatches. Okay, so I'm gonna go down and see if anybody has any questions. I don't really have anything that I'm asking about this weekend. You know, we're good to go on our. Grommets and laying out the sails, and that's what this table's all about today. So what I'm going to get this crew doing is measuring out. Yeah, we need a way of getting that bolt to sit up so you can just pull the material off of it.
Well, we just need to fix the leg on that stand.
Okay, if that works.
It worked before.
Well, they were all the way down. They were set down on the ground.
Well, we can block them off.
Okay.
That's not a big deal.
Is that what you're going to do, Bart?
Make it very conspicuous.
Because it really worked great.
Oh, that left.
And it was out of the way?
I guess we could put it at the end of the table and just sit off there.
Well, it's going to unroll on it. I mean, is that you're going to measure from that end or you're going to...
Yeah, we need to layer tapes out.
Are you going to put our zero from that end, and in which case you want to unroll it this way, so your zero is always down there?
No, in my head, it was coming from where it is there. Is that stainless?
Yeah.
How about a... Just use the square tubing we used last time. Okay, folks. Very pleasant Memorial Day to you. Did you recheck any questions? Betsy?
Oh, sorry, I'm multitasking.
Yeah, don't multitask. Let's see if anybody's got anything there. Oh, no, I know what I want to do. I haven't talked to Craig. I haven't talked to Craig and answered yet.
I'll ask about the pressure within the skeg.
Really? Pressure within the skeg. That's an odd question. We tested the skeg to, I think it was 3.5 PSI. And let's see. Somebody came through here. Oh, was it Peter Zila? Somebody I was talking to about diesel engines, and they recommended, no, it wasn't Peter. Peter Zila's been here. Oh, I forgot to show you the welder. We got to go back up on the boat. All right. Hey, Craig, Andrew. Hey, Craig, put some clothes on. Jeez. All right, I'm going to be back. Talk to you in a little bit. I got to show you something else up there. That's what else happened this
Andrew's
week.
Andrew's here. I'm not naked.
All right. Well, let me talk. Just hang tight for a little bit. Right,
sure.
Come on up, Andrew.
Oh, okay.
We can talk in the pilot house away from noise. Peter Zila came by the other week, and he is a welder extraordinaire. He goes around and he talks about, or he represents HTP welders, and they wanted the normal deal of demonstrate a welder for. I don't do that. You know, if somebody wants to give me equipment, I take it. But I don't make any deals about what I'm going to say about it, what I'm going to do with it, I guess it's part of, I have enough money in my life that I don't need the income. So freedom to me is very valuable. That's why I guess I like Memorial Day a lot too. It's kind of about freedom, and I think, you know, it's great to have freedom, but if you don't use it, what the hell? You know, I'm not going to enslave myself to anybody for merchandising their gear. If I do that, I'll let you know, okay? But I'm not doing that. So, but he dropped off this welder, and it's a Pulse MIG welder, and I knew what I was getting because I used a Miller Pulse welder, like a 350P or something, years ago when I was visiting some guys over at... air gas, and I just loved it because I mean it could lay down, you know, I was testing silicon bronze wire patching the propeller blades, and it could lay down this spread out bead of silicon bronze weld. It was just gorgeous. Then I came home and used my Hobart, you know, Iron Man 610 with the spool gun on the back of it that I wrapped a copper coil around to keep it cool and from melting down. And it wasn't anything like the spray, the Pulse. I mean, and you can weld thin aluminum with it. It's a great machine. So if it holds up, I'm very happy with it. He gave me his used one. And that's like, I'm fine with that because I like used machines because they're broken in. I got this Longevity and it was brand new. And I got a buddy to run it hard for the right off the bat, because in the first 30 days, I don't know, they're about the policy now. First 30 days, if it broke, you could send it, they would pay shipping back to them. And sure enough, 5 hours into it, bang, you know, the thing goes dead. So we sent it back and got another one. He finished on that. So this is a broken welder too. But anyway, that's that Pulse welder down there. That is a beautiful machine, and I think we're going to really like it. It does TIG, stick, and MIG. And it does stick and pulse, which is weird. We haven't tried that out yet, but we've welded aluminum with it already and silicon bronze. And Jesus, is it nice. It makes a weird noise to work with, though. The cots are up here because the guys are camping out up here.
Hobo camp invasion.
Yeah, they can't. Let's see. So, yeah, that's kind of weird. All four of our welders are here together today.
Yeah, Vincent just told us to bring them all down.
Yeah.
The welders?
Well, she said that it might crane the welders down, but she told us to bring, like, everything that we can carry down.
Just on account of the storm coming.
Oh, right. Yeah, that's not a bad idea. Okay.
Let's talk to. I want to let you talk to this guy for a little bit.
Sure.
Okay. He's really shy about being on camera. Okay.
Still got clothes on.
I know.
Yeah, he's got clothes on. He's not covered in mud. Those are good things. You had what's remarkable to me about you is you got this strange PhD thing that you did.
Uh-huh.
Tell him what that's all about.
Okay.
You look into the camera because you're used to it.
Oh, totally.
You may have recognized him. What's the show you did? Is.
Hi, I'm Andy Quidmeyer from Hacking the Wild.
That's it. Hacking the Wild. I've seen a couple episodes of it. It was a great little show. He takes a backpack. They're trying to do a show on what he's really done in real life.
Yeah.
And without the drama. That's your PhD. Explain that.
Okay, so my PhD was all about how we can use DIY digital electronics and little programmable things to try to make devices that kind of connect us with nature. So I work with a lot of like field biologists, and we go off into like jungles in Panama, and we try to make weird little like gizmos that'll track bats or let us know what the ants are up to.
Give me a firm example of like something. What did you count? Did it count the ants as they walk by?
I'll give you a really concrete example. Is I had a friend who studied these ants that live inside these trees. So the ants, their goal, they have a symbiosis with the tree. The tree gives them food and shelter. And in return, the ants act like a force field in case any kind of like leaf-eating sloth wants to climb up it and start eating all the leaves.
Ants that bite you when you mess with the tree?
Oh, yes. They bite the hell out of you. So I had a friend who was studying how the ants figure out when the tree's being attacked and things like that. And so one of the other things that attack these trees is like woodpeckers. And so we made like a little robotic woodpecker device, really just an Arduino with a little thing that would just tap, 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 tap with the rhythm of like the woodpeckers in the jungle. And then he would film and try to do some computer vision tracking to see how many ants, when do the ants come, like what's the delay between when the woodpecker attacks and when they come. And it's nice because by making our own simple little robot, even though it's very simple, we have like a calibrated woodpecker that we can use. So
it's always the same tap.
Exactly. It's always the same tap, always the same kind of rhythm. We can even, he tries to make the force exactly the same.
From one tree to another tree.
Exactly. And so he wants to see, does one ant colony have a different personality than another ant colony? Is this the ant colony that's like, whatever. And this ant colony's like, who's touching my tree?
You mean like Jamaican ants as opposed to like,
businessman ants.
Yeah, yeah. East Coast versus West Coast ants.
Exactly, yeah. So those would be the kind of things that we would build. And so for me, working with a lot of these field biologists, one of the things that we learn is the way that the current systems work is the engineers do the engineering and the field biologists run around and play in the woods. And for me, especially on the engineering side, that always seems super unfair. I want to run around and play in the woods. And on the biologist side, the first thing that happens anytime you bring any technology out into the wild to test it, it breaks. And so it would always be like, okay, we give the biologists the tools, they bring it out, they break it, and then they have to wait till their field season's over, and then bring it back, and then we fix it, and then so on and so on. And I thought that was terrible. And I want the biologist to be self-reliant and for them to be able to, you know, make and manipulate these tools however they want. If he wants to make it some other kind of woodpecker or whatever, he can totally change it around. And he did. And so what I started doing is instead of us engineering electronics types sitting in the lab, I tried to move the lab into the jungle. So we'd get a backpack. We would do these things called hiking hacks. Sorry for the air quotes, Doug.
But
we would do these hiking hacks where we would load up a backpack with all these electronics, our soldering irons, everything, and figure out ways this lab could exist cut off from any kind of, you know, normal resources you have, like, you know, standard electricity. We'd have to use solar panels and butane-powered soldering irons and all this kind of stuff. And so I've been doing that for a little bit. And also exploring other places. So I did one in Madagascar and Panama and the U.S., trying to do some in Singapore now. And then I started even getting into just like mobile maker spaces in general. And that's one thing that really interests me about the SV Seeker is, you know, this is going to be a place where awesome biologists are going to be working out in the wild. And what kind of tools and what kind of infrastructure do we need that can facilitate whatever they're doing? If they have some sort of, you know, $500,000 acoustic equipment out here and, you know, it shorts out, you want to be able to fix it and repair it or make it even more awesome, depending on whatever your new questions that come up while you're in the field.
Yeah.
So I've been trying to look into more marine projects as well. If you look up, there's a project called the Boat Lab that I made last year in the Philippines. And so we built our own floating bamboo maker space to kind of monitor this this coral reef that was in this marine protected area in a little.
That mixed art in as well.
Yeah, exactly. And so that's another key thing for me is really this combination.
Hang on. What?
Mental interference.
Okay. We'll move. All right. Those of you trying to watch live are apparently experiencing the suckiness of boat interference. So we're going to remove this interview, but you can always watch it on YouTube. You can catch the full thing. Oh yeah, let's go down and find another shady spot. Oh, my teeth sitting out there. Go on.
Okay. So we're talking about art and science, and that's a real key combination for me, because for me and a lot of scientists would agree, there's no point to finding out all these cool new ideas about how the natural world works if you make these ideas accessible to people in the world. And so art is a key way to take these ideas that can be very, very narrow and very specific about, you know, how this particular ant behaves and bring it out to the larger world so that people like us humans who might not have that much contact with how, you know, Panamanian ants act in the middle of this specific jungle,
right.
Maybe we can bring those ideas out to people and let them kind of interact or engage and, you know, get a feel for how these different systems work.
That's always been the problem, isn't it? You guys come up with these fantastic finds out in the field, but nobody gives a shit because
it's not
tied into anything else.
And it'll
get, see how it relates to them.
Exactly. And it'll get locked away in like, you know, a research paper that, you know, your average Joe's not going to pick this up and be able to parse all the scientific jargon.
I don't read that stuff either.
And often these things is, there's terrible things too with the research journals. They try to lock off all the scientific information. Yeah, so like, you know, most scientists are funded by things like, let's say, well, they used to be, things like the NSF, National Science Foundation would pay grants for scientists to do research, and the idea is that taxpayers are investing money in people finding new cool things about the world.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, these scientists are forced to publish in these journals that then charge. They lock off all this information
you
they come up with.
You were talking about that the other day. That's freaking me out.
Yeah, and so like, unless you have you know, thousands of dollars that you can buy a journal subscription yourself, or you're part of some elite academic university, you can't just find this information yourself. So there's really cool folks at like these rogue organizations. One's called Sci-Hub. And they go and they basically pirate all of this information that the taxpayers have already paid for, and they liberate it. And so you can find any of these journal articles. But so even if you can access these journal articles, it's still difficult to read and to understand. So that's one of the key roles of art. How do you bring the human experience,
well,
connect people emotionally?
That makes you such a great teacher, too. Like any good teacher should be, is you can take the complex and you can dumb it down so somebody like me, A, will pay attention to you first, and B, will actually understand what it is you're trying to convey to me. Yeah.
And the entertainment's kind of a key part about that.
Yeah. So you're like, putting science into social media and making it, because that's where you watch it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And yeah, that's one of the things about, like, you know, doing weird things like, I don't know, a reality TV show about surviving is, to
you
me,
talk about that?
Pretty weird. I can talk about it a little bit just in
that. Tell them a little bit about, let me back the camera up a little bit.
Okay.
You're taller than I imagine.
Stand
Stay where you are.
So, all
right.
You know, he was talking about how one of the goals of a teacher is you have to get people's attention, and then you have to be able to connect them with key issues and things like that. So one of the main things that I do, and from my research, has been about moving maker spaces and places that you work from very human environments to places like in the middle of an ocean or in the middle of a jungle.
Or a swamp,
exactly. And so building cool tools out in the wild. And it's I find it fascinating. It inspires you and it shows you what all the issues you need to deal with are constantly. Because maybe in your mind you have all these assumptions like, oh, I'll be in the swamp in a week and I'll make this thing that stretches from here to here. And you're like, oh, wait, but there's nothing to stand on. So you'll have these ideas in your head and you'll build a really cool thing. And then suddenly you get there and the thing totally doesn't work.
Yeah.
And so when you build in the place you're working with, you're like, oh, I obviously can't build this here because it'll sink in the mud or a gator will eat it or things like that. So people saw a lot of my previous PhD research, some of these Hollywood producers, and they wanted to make a TV show about it, and they didn't tell me later that it was going to be a survival TV show. But I still ended up going through with it, and even though I personally feel that they really play up a lot of the dangers.
No, you think so?
Oh, yes, exactly. And, you know, part of the reason that is to get, you know, your average TV viewer, like, interested
it's
and, like,
wired into
entertained.
500,000 years of human development. The one thing we pay attention to is, oh, got killed doing that shit. Let's not do that.
Exactly. So, in a way, we're trying to tap into those, you know, like, inert caveman tendencies of, like, oh, my God, is he going to die?
Yeah,
but for me, the goal is trying to use that to get across this very simple message of, like, hey, go out, play in nature, explore, and explore tools and electronics and build something you've never built before and also try to build it outside because it's really fun. You're going to learn something.
Yeah.
And one of the really cool things that I like from the show is less some of these grumpier dudes who are just like, well, what are you doing with the soldering iron out in the forest? And more of like little kids who see it, and then they go and start building electronics and, you know, playing around in their own backyard. So that's the parts that are really cool to me.
Yeah. It's inspiring because, you know, I think about when I like, that's the times and moments of my childhood that I enjoyed, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I just had a magnifying glass, you know, burning the ants.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, it'd be so much more fun to build something that actually counts them, you know?
Yeah.
The ants would appreciate it too, I think. A few burned.
Just a little bit that you know, have to.
You gotta have some losses along the way. Well, thanks for coming down and joining us. I really appreciate what you're doing.
Super happy to be back.
You're back to here, do this again. I hope it's become a routine thing. Oh, tell them about the boat. Tell them about the boat.
Oh, yeah. So another cool thing that we're doing at the National University of Singapore, I'm part of a project to try to purchase a dedicated sailboat for the university. And the cool thing is Singapore is a little island nation.
It's wood. It's a wood hull boat.
It's made out of wood. Yeah, it's a wood hull boat. I think it's cool. I have very little experience sailing. We were constantly fixing things on board, and Doug has let me know if we purchase it. We're going to do a lot more of that. But
it's endless. And I don't even have mine in the water yet. I'm still starting to fix them already.
And part of the role of this boat is it's going to be a multidisciplinary project. So we get people involved from all over the campus. And
you mean
so
like engineers.
Exactly. And so one of the things is like engineers and designers working on it just for like fixing the boat or like redoing different parts of that. It's like a project that they can have. Like even if they're not out at sea, like we're going to have, you know, a class that's dedicated to like redoing the solar panels on boat,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
rigging up an electrical drive. They're thinking about doing that, which is kind of interesting.
An e-drive on how big a boat?
I would say 3/4 the size of yours.
Still a big boat.
Length and width, yeah. It's still pretty big.
I've actually looked at e-drives for a little while. Electric motor pushing the boat around, but you get a lot of battery.
Yeah.
You know, it's really a good thing. I think it's a great thing if you're trying to stay quiet.
Hmm.
And if for science, there are some reasons to stay quiet.
Exactly.
You're not moving the boat far. You're just doing a small little push.
Yeah, and that's one of the things when we were on our trip, we were doing a lot of acoustics work.
Yeah.
And so trying to, you know.
Tell them about that, because that's coming up. I got a guy coming through that's with the Dolphin program.
Yeah.
Say a little bit about the acoustics.
Yeah, so they apparently have a guy who's coming here who does a bunch of acoustic work.
Just do what you did out there.
Yeah, but our stuff, we were with a guy named Matthias, super awesome dolphin and whale expert. He builds these amazing hydrophone cameras. So it's like a little camera in the middle that's hooked up to an array of different hydrophones around. And so you can use it to see where different ultrasonic frequencies are coming from. So if you look at a pod of dolphins and you want to know who's talking with you, you can see like, oh, it pinpoints.
Really?
Yeah, the talking
cool.
is like, oh, Henry the dolphin is talking to Sally. Yeah, and it's all underwater.
Diver held.
It's all sealed. Yeah, it's... Yeah.
So you can pick the dolphin in the pod out that's actually doing this communication.
And you can pick out like what part of like the whale's body is actually producing the sounds. Because there's still questions like that. They don't necessarily know, like, it's not like they're making it with their vocal cords.
God, we're
they
stupid
have, like,
about this stuff, isn't it?
Yeah, there's it's
amazing how much we don't know.
Totally. Yeah. There's
about dolphins that stay on the surface. We're not even talking about, you know, giant squid or anything like that.
Yeah. Yeah, and so they're going out and they're doing stuff with dolphins on the surface, in captivity, but also really in the wild, too. And that's where a lot of their really cool gear and technology comes from. And for me, the fascinating thing is, how do you make these very delicate, very precise electronic instruments that can withstand, you know, saltwater corrosion and, you know, scientists smashing it around or jumping off a boat to try to hunt down this, you know, humpback or something like that.
Right.
And so how does it withstand the abuse of the wild and the abuse of us?
Right. And being able to fix that in the field is
exactly.
Vital. It costs so much to get these boats out on location that it breaks. And I've seen that happen on real researchers. It's like,
yeah.
And the fiber optic cable broke. So yep. They're 3 days back to port.
Yeah.
2 days
and
in
tens
port.
Of thousands of dollars
every
single day.
Every single day.
Okay.
Yeah. All right, enough of that. I don't want you to bore them.
Anyway, it's a wonderful
Andrew.
Place. I'm so glad to be back here.
All right, great. Let's talk to. See, we get some cool people coming by here, and not just PhDs. I mean, there's a. You know what we had here last week? You'll see him. His name is Francis. And I didn't know we had. Hey, Craig.
Craig.
Yeah, we got to do a piece with Craig. He was a hobo, and seriously down to earth, real live hobo. He walked off the tracks over there, and we were watching him. He sat down on the curb over there, and he was like, "Can I wave to him?" He waves back, and he's waiting for us to take a break. We take a break. He rings doorbell, and it's Francis. And he brought me a. It's in my little treasure box now. He brought me a buffalo head. Is that right? A buffalo nickel.
I've been waiting to see this legendary coin.
Well, you've seen them. Have you ever seen a buffalo nickel?
Maybe, like...
Dude, how old are you? This is Craig.
33.
Hey. He's brought me a buffalo nickel to put under the mask. Uh-huh. So we're going to figure out a way to get this thing in there, because this dude is cool. For 15 years, Francis moved around the country working odd jobs, but he moved around the country on freight trains. And I learned more about what train to get onto, how to decide which trains, how to get past security at the train yards. You know.
He's 75.
He's 75 years old. He came out here from California 5 weeks by Memphis, Tennessee, and freight trains and steps off the tracks over here. You know. Now, he did have to catch a bus from Oklahoma City up to here because we don't run freight trains that way. It's getting harder and harder. You know. But the best ride is... plastic pellets, open bin cars.
Oh, you just like
pellets.
Lay out them.
It's
probably.
Like a huge bean bag, you know. So I'm like, yeah. So anyway.
I knew a dude that hopped trains around the Northeast in like the Catskills area, and he said,
a guy that lived up there.
Yeah, and he said his best finds were the trains that were carrying automobiles because they all had the keys in them, and so you could get in and you could turn on the heat and you could turn on the radio. And you're just sitting in this
car.
Don't
try it anymore. Francis says they have a lot of cops up there now because people steal radios and stuff out of the cars. They've lost so much money on it.
Yeah.
So it's a mixture of... He makes very distinctive separations.
Mm-hmm.
Hobos move around and work, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
And then there's a criminal element to it, and then there's a drug element to it.
Yeah. So those three groups are out there on the track. It's not a safe thing to do. It's a dangerous thing to do. So everybody that says, well, running into that grinder is dangerous, go try riding freight trains for 15 years and keeping your ass alive, okay? That may be considered more dangerous. But anyway, a fascinating band and a remarkable life. And he plays the ukulele, so we're going to have a video up here. I got a lot of video to edit. I just haven't gotten to it. So you're going to have to just suffer with the live show. An amazing guy is standing beside me, too. Craig works, or do you run it? Are you in the...
I started it.
And you started it?
Yeah, me and a friend started it.
He's freaking awesome.
Oh, thanks.
I did not know that.
Yeah, we...
He's got an organization. I'll tell you what I know about it, and I'll let you start talking, because you actually know. Concrete Jungle. And it's an amazing idea, and it's around the world now, because you had an internet, your first ever...
Your first internet.
Okay, yeah. You had two people from out of the country, maybe, you know, but it's a great idea. Yeah. What they do is they help food banks by collecting unused and harvests that would normally not be collected because it's too hard to get to, or it's an abandoned field, or it's crops that were specifically planted for them. That is for them to use. So go ahead, tell them more about Concrete Jungle.
So our big thing that we do with Concrete Jungle is we found that there were tons of just fruit trees all over Atlanta because we actually inherited some cider equipment. And we're like, okay, well, we need apples for these. So we started going all over Atlanta and just discovered that there are like apple trees everywhere. So we would buy freezers off Craigslist and just store them full of apples like all summer.
Yeah, I used to have one in my yard. You couldn't get them away because they all come due. They all come out at the same time.
Exactly.
You got this glut.
And people were more than happy to give them to us because
I would have been.
Even if they wanted them, they don't want 600 pounds of them.
Yeah. So it's like I'd feed the horse. It's like the horse was like, oh no, not another apple, man.
Totally. And so it started just as this big party, and eventually it just got like bigger and bigger, and we would have, you know, like trampolines and pedal-powered apple grinders and just like music and dogs.
So it's like a festival to do cider?
Yeah, Cider Fest is what we would do. And then one year, we got like a ton and a half of apples. And it was just like, just became work. Like we had to like just work through the night making all this cider and it kind of sucked. But like we all kind of started as dumpster divers and like we really hated seeing this stuff go to waste.
Right.
But we didn't want it. So, like, okay, like, maybe we can donate it. And every place we talked to was like, yeah, definitely, like, bring us everything that you can. And from there, we started noticing all the other stuff that is growing. And this is in Atlanta, which is, like, sort of...
It's a city. Atlanta is in Georgia for you guys watching us internationally. Yeah. And it's like this. It's hot and muggy. This is your kind of weather
here. It's hot
and
muggy. Yeah. And it's like a city, but it's like, it has great weather and it's surprisingly rural in a lot of places. Like,
and it is a huge city.
And it's just, there's no boundaries to
Atlanta at rush hour. The traffic is horrendous.
But our interstate is no longer collapsed.
Oh, they fixed it?
They fixed it.
But on the other side of town, it doesn't even, before you get to Bellingham, it turns into a street, for crying out loud. It's not even a highway after a while. Anyway, that's another story. But anyway, so you found all this. There's trees and open areas and parks and all this stuff all over Atlanta.
And we have this concept that we call, like, the fruit eyes or the fruit goggles, where, like, you'll see a certain type of tree for the first time. You're like, oh, pears, or like, oh, service pears or something. And then you'll see two or three more, and then you'll see like 200. Like, there's just something about your mind, like, starts to pick out this detail in the world.
We were walking along the street last night, he spots a plum was laying on the gutter.
Plums,
A plum was laying in the gutter. There's a plum tree around here. It's like, jeez.
Yeah.
That's just fruit eyes working.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, it's kind of cool, because you just, like, start picking up on a detail of the world.
So you've identified a map of all these places, and you hit them all with volunteers?
We try to hit as many as we can. Our map has almost 3,000 trees on it right now, just in Atlanta. There's also someone from an organization called Falling Fruit, and they're doing a fruit tree map of the whole world. And they've got, like, several million trees on there.
So if somebody's in their town, where would the... You know, if somebody's watching this and they're interested in getting involved in an organization like that, is there a resource that they could go to find it in their local area?
Falling Fruit is probably a really good spot for just mapping stuff, because they've worked with lots of cities in getting, like, actual tree inventories of what they have planted. But honestly, you just go out and do it. because it's everywhere.
Find your food bank and find your trees and start like you did.
Yeah, and
what
so
are the
many,
things that you guys need as an organization? What's the things that's missing the most often for y'all?
One of the biggest challenges that we have is kind of the logistics of it. That we have almost 3,000 trees in the Atlanta area, and they're spread out over an area of like 500 square miles. Like it's a city, and so trees are really unpredictable, and so. One of the things we've been trying to do for the past few years is we have a partnership with Georgia Tech to come up with, like, how can we improve the logistics of picking these trees? Because
you want to be at the tree at the right time.
Yeah. And, you know, one year, like, this apple tree might make fruit on July 4th, and then the next year it might be July 10th, and then the next year after that it might not do anything. And the people that own these trees don't care about them, so they're not going to really, like, go out of their way to do anything for them. So we, with Georgia Tech, we're trying to make sensors that we could put in a tree or like detect something on the tree.
You're gonna wire the tree?
Yeah. That's what I want to do. Well, so we originally wanted to do a drone where the drone would fly up to the tree,
monitor it,
just take a photo of it and come back, and that was it. And this was around the time where like the FAA didn't really know what they were doing with drones.
Yeah.
And so they sent a strongly worded letter to Georgia Tech basically threatening their federal research money if they found out that we were doing unauthorized drone
douchebags.
I think they've lightened up a bit now.
If a plane's flying down anywhere close to the altitude of a fruit tree, he ain't anywhere he's supposed to be.
Yeah.
That's not 500 feet. Anyway.
Yeah. So then from there we're trying to do like bend sensors. Like put a bend sensor on a branch in a tree, and then it gets heavy with pears, and then the branch bends over, and it sends us a text message or something like that.
Cool.
The thing that I'm most excited about, which might also be the least practical, is an array of gas sensors, where we could smell something that the fruit is giving off as it's ripening.
Right.
Because most fruits give off lots of different gases.
Yeah, apple trees did.
And we actually work with a guy in Denmark on this, and he does amazing stuff with these just cheapo off-the-shelf sensors. He can smell the difference between different types of olive oils, and he recently had a customs officer contact him about like detecting pot that was being transported through the country. I know, yeah, that's like a whole...
In Denmark? Do they care?
It was, like, I think it was a French customs officer.
Oh, okay.
But he can like smell different spices, different varieties of hops, like get into really subtle stuff that maybe humans can't even do that.
It sounds like he's trying to standardize like some of the testers that they use.
Yeah, and even I think his big approach here is like we could get a sensor that would smell this gas called ethylene, which is what many fruits give off as they ripen. But it's like tens of thousands of dollars, and it's like parts per billion accurate because it's meant to be stuck in a big Apple warehouse. And, you know, if something goes wrong with your ethylene level, you're losing $20 million of apples, which is not at all practical for us. And so his approach is like use these cheapo $2 Chinese sensors and just have like really rigorous like statistical approaches and process control, and you can get really good results from them. And so we're trying to do that too. It's a little, we've successfully smelled some fruits ripen. We've done persimmons, and you can see stuff go up and to the right. And
is it something that you could put around a set of trees and pick up? I mean, how close proximity does that have to be to a tree? Or do you
pretty
know
close,
yet?
Pretty close, I think, yeah.
In the tree.
Yeah, in the tree.
Yeah, that way it doesn't matter which way the wind's blowing, really.
Yeah, and it's not... It is the least practical, probably. Probably the most practical is...
You don't
like,
know until you're done.
Yeah.
We start some things on this boat, it's like, this thing, it worked really well.
Actually, yeah, not too bad. We may also just do, like, a small camera, like a really low-power, send us a photo once a week camera, and, you know, put batteries in it in February, and then come get them in June or whatever when you pick them up.
Cool.
And so... Yeah, I'm really trying to...
She's telling us we've run long. Yeah.
My God, you're an hour and 3 minutes. We have a bad connection, and we're losing bodies.
Well, I don't care. I'll put this up on YouTube. The Facebook people, they get
I'm just
easy.
Hoping that our guests from Concrete Jungle will want to investigate our blackberry bushes.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Are they making fruit?
I don't know.
Ready.
Making thorns.
Yeah.
They had some green ones last time I mowed.
Did they?
Yeah.
All right.
I'll investigate.
Oh.
Did you notice any strawberries out there when you're laying out the sail this morning?
No.
You're on top of my old strawberry crop. I got tired of it and mowed it.
I was just
it.
Looking for dog shit.
Well, yeah, that's probably the appropriate thing to be looking for.
Resting piece of pie.
What?
Strawberries gone. Rest in peace of pie.
Oh, yeah. Rest in peace of pie. Very cute.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. For STD Seeker, anybody want to say anything else? Bye, Andrew.
Bye,
Andrew. Kitty. Jonas. Bart, say goodbye.
How are you doing?
All right, we're getting ready to roll out material. What'd you make today?